Let's see. You know what I'm going to go with? The franchise, Shane Douglas and Ash Williams. It's going to be the pre-show matchup while I do the social media thing and get people to start showing up. So let's go ahead and start doing that. We're here. Hopefully my levels aren't dog shit this week. It's a shame that you can't do asymmetrical parts on anything except the torso and the head, because being able to give Ash a shoot chainsaw would be very cool. Or even characters that have like a glove on one hand, like Kane, for example, you can't really do either. Up. being said, this Ash Williams does look really good. I am continually impressed with what the community is able to put together, even before PartsCraft has come out, because I have seen some stuff with the PartsCraft DLC. Watching Melly's stream on Sunday, they did just have one of the boos from the Super Mario Brothers family of games using the boo's own sprites in the PartsCraft, and it was very funny. Maybe I throw a pile of money at Zero and start getting custom parts made of me and my friends. Although, that's a cool idea in theory, but also in practice, I do not have a pile of money. And it's a damn shame, because he does good work. I mean, just seeing some of the stuff he's done for Blake's stream recently. Shane Douglas running that gas. So is Ash Williams. It's gotta be it. Yep. Stomach off for the victory. Ashley Williams, showing the world that he still got it. Although, honestly, this reminds me more than anything that there is still nowhere that I can legally watch Megas XLR, which Bruce Campbell did a few episodes in. And that's extremely fucked up. I mean, it does make a compelling case for piracy. Because, like, hey, literally no one will sell you this thing. For stupid tax reasons, as far as I'm aware. But, sometimes you just want to watch, giant robots. But I digress. As, it is getting pretty close to showtime here. I am gonna do is have everybody get on your feet, make some noise, as we have another edition of Blake's House Professional Wrestling.
Counting up in your gripping hands through
Welcome, Blake's House Wrestling fans, to another edition of Blake's House Professional Wrestling. If you were tuned in last week, you saw in the main events Maglo and Terrell, the two top contenders for the Blake's House heavyweight title, going head-to-head, not in singles, but in tag team action. Now, their partners, we are doing the intro right now, so you are all good. Of course, neither Maglo nor Terrell able to pick up a pinfall victory over one another. Would actually be Ramon with that devastating Dr. Bomb, putting Alpizar on the shelf. Alpizar is going to get a chance at revenge in singles action this week. And next week will be the decisive matchup between Maglo and Terrell Benjamin for that number one contender spot. Additionally, we saw Baby Man bring out a brand new enforcer, the absolutely legendary tag team wrestler that is Floyd Bartholomew. The man that was able to best the Gatekeeper in under 8 minutes take on Robert Walsh and John Newton in tag team action. However, Newton, a world warrior of sorts, a man that has been in contention right on the cusp of every major championship in Blake's House Professional Wrestling. And last week was no exception, as he was able to score a pinfall victory over the Knicks Wrestling Organization champion, Baby Man, in that tag team contest. And that has immediately put him in contention. And a number one contender for that title will be decided this week, as David Clement, Brad Chad, Dick Bruiser, and now John Newton going to be competing Fatal 4-Way action for that number one contender spot. Additionally, of course, the tag team titles are being sought after by one team of Frank Vista, and Dan Ramadan, as they have been on a very impressive winning streak week in and week out, and are the de facto number one contenders. Well, Frank Vista going to be competing in singles action against tag team champion Bobby Goodwin. It is going to be grappler versus grappler in what is sure to be an instant classic. Now, some very interesting developments backstage. Maglo not participating in this week's show, but as I said, very interesting development. The person carrying the load of this open challenge format, it is going to be DJ Dix, the man that we all believe to be exercised. Came out in a surprise return to assist Terrell Benjamin and now is holding court officially in this Blake's House wrestling ring. But let's not waste any more of your time. We've got quite a lot of card to get through this evening. And let's start things off with our opening contest. Linda Alpizar going head-to-head with Nock Voldo, and that's right now. We'll be right back. has been quite a while since we have seen Linda Alpizar in Blake's House Wrestling action. She typically tags with her husband, Eric, but Eric has been, has had other obligations. We have to see if Ring Rust is a factor, and it appears to be, as Voldo getting off to a strong start at the open of this contest, but Linda doing what she can to cut off that momentum. See, do not allow her smaller stature to fool you as she bests Voldo in a test of strength, but Voldo responding back with a devastating cutter. She uses his freaky magic to gain that upper hand. Absolutely enigmatic wrestler. Using that freaky magic to spit fire into the face of Alpizar, but Alpizar able to sidestep that devastating attack, and right now Alpizar just putting those educated feet to good use, as well as a big boy senton right into the back of Voldo, but Voldo firing Alpizar into that corner turnbuckle. Looks like we are going high risk very early in this matchup here.
Oh, yeah!
As Voldo just absolutely disrespectful and going right into that Frankensteiner. Big frog splash off the top, cover two. And Linda powering out of that pin attempt. And once again, just delivering that boot to that lower abdomen of Voldo. Although too much momentum, this like a freight train in this contest, unable to be stopped, but now Linda targeting the face, the masked face of one Nock Voldo. But another massive frog splash, and Voldo looking to make some kind of a statement here, trying to assert the dominance of this Knicks wrestling organization as we start, as the weeks count down.
Finished!
That NWO special program, but Linda not the type to take that disrespect lightly as she goes super kick after super kick. Welcome to the party, pal, as a big boy senton buried into the gut. Linda just trying to choke Voldo out, and Voldo elbow to the face, able to escape that hold, and now merry-go-round hold, but a foot on the bottom rope will break up. That pinning attempt. Again, Nock Voldo just attempting to assert the dominance of this Knicks wrestling organization stable, and once again, just what a maneuver, absolutely devastating. That is going to be it. As I said, the Knicks wrestling organization locker room looking to assert their dominance over the other major stables in Blake's House Wrestling as we are going into this Knicks wrestling organization special program. But we're going to keep this show rolling as we have got some more interstable action here. Joey Bagi, the uncrowned king of Judgment Pro Wrestling, going to be going head-to-head with Brandon this week. Of course, Joey has to be vying for a title shot for that Judgment Pro Wrestling title. He is another man that has come so close, so many times, but never quite able to reach the peak of this company. But that journey is going to be starting from humble beginnings near the bottom of the card as he goes head-to-head with Brandon this week, and that match is right now. Mentioned before these two men made their way to the ring, Joey is almost certainly looking through Brandon. Brandon is not the opponent that Joey has in mind. Now Brandon's good friend Josh Kaiser, the man that stole that Judgment Pro Wrestling Championship from A-Man, is certainly the opponent that Joey Bagi has got his sights set on, but as I said, he is going to have to rise in the ranks. No title shot, no title opportunity is guaranteed in Blake's House Professional Wrestling. No matter how long you've been with the company, no matter how famous you are, you have got to fight your way to the top just like everybody else, and Joey starting that fight tonight. But the educated feet of one Joey Bagi certainly going to do him a lot of favors as he starts that climb, as that super kick of his is just absolutely frightening to behold. But thus far, Brandon giving Joey very few opportunities to use those explosive kicks of his. Joey going high risk now. Big diving headbutt, but it is unable to connect as Brandon rolls out of the way. And again, Brandon just so effective at slowing Joey down, and you have to be, because this man is so determined, so dangerous, and so effective once he gets ahead of steam. And Brandon is doing everything he can to prevent that from happening. Brandon possibly also interested in that Judgment Pro Wrestling title. Joey able to roll out of the way of that diving elbow, and this has just changed the landscape of this match. Brandon able to lock on this patented spinning toe hold. Shades of the People's Champion Maglo, but hold on, roll up cover one. Ooh, but only one. Brandon fighting his way to his feet. But certainly just because Brandon and Kaiser are good friends does not mean that he is not interested in that title himself, but as I said, no title shots guaranteed in this company. And Joey is certainly a formidable first opponent as you start that climb. Joey's starting to get some opportunities to put those indicated feet of his to good use, but Brandon blocking the suplex, throwing one of his own, and again, Brandon just trying to cut Joey off at every step, and again, locking on that spinning toehold. Trying to take away some of that kicking power from Joey here, but big atomic drop, and Brandon is absolutely floored by it. Brandon again fighting his way to his feet, and Brandon, always a scrapper, something of a brawler. He is never one that you can afford to count out in any given situation, but big DDT planting Joey, and now Brandon going up top once again, and this time the diving elbow will connect. Joey just doesn't have it in him to roll out of the way of that dive. Big fireman's carry buster from Brandon. Cover one, two. Count two. Joey back to basics with that body slam, but getting a count of two out it. That's how you know this match is absolutely taking its toll on Brandon. Despite how long he has spent on top in this contest, just keeping up with Joey is a challenge, but right now it looks like Brandon's doing more than keep up with him, but Joey looking to change that big back body drop, and Joey again going up top. Connecting with a diving elbow of his own. Here is a receipt, my friend. Cover two. But only gets two. And Joey getting fired up, delivering one of those patented super kicks. And the floodgates have absolutely opened here, because when you see one, you know another one is coming soon. Brandon going to do everything he can to not take another one of those. Joey again able to roll out of the way of that diving elbow, but Brandon again fighting back to his feet. Brandon so accomplished as a brawler. Big enziguri trying to take the head clean off Brandon's shoulders now. And Joey is starting to get in a rhythm, and that is very dangerous if you are Brandon in this contest. Scissors after head scissors. And hold on just a second here. Scoop and a slam center of the ring. Joey getting hyped up here, running cross country springboard, elbow buried in the heart of one Brandon Lang, and cover two. And Brandon barely able to get a shoulder off the mat. Going to deliver a flashing elbow of his own. That hold clearly taking something out of Joey almost as much as it did Brandon here. And now running cross country himself, and a clubbing blow to the throat, but the educated feet of Joey Bagi going puts a good use, and a big falling fist off the top. Brandon out on his feet. Looks like Brandon now taking things in that high orange Gatorade district, but Joey fighting his way off him, and big body splash off the top. This has got to be it. Cover two, three count fall. And you live and you die by the high risk maneuver. Brandon shoved off of that top turnbuckle. Joey able to pick up the victory with that body splash, and Joey's journey just beginning, but off to a very strong start. As he looks to get back in contention for that Judgment Pro Wrestling Championship. And we are going to keep this interstable action going. As we are continuing to follow Kurt London's protege, Jason Solarion, in some tag team action tonight. It is going to be this tag team of Sterling and Zero Lopez taking on this upstart tag team here. And that match, it's next. Sterling certainly best known for their crusade against this Dark Hour stable, but hold on, Solarion already starting things off hot, blasting Sterling to the outside, and Sterling clearly unhappy with that level of disrespect, getting a steel chair from ringside, but he is disarmed by Solarion, and Solarion getting things, he's going here, and that is certainly not to be unexpected. Solarion and Kurt London both known for their blistering pace in matches. Ramon Sterling fired into that orange Gatorade corner. And Solarion just brutalizing Sterling with a series of kicks. And Sterling now going to be going back to his own corner. And hold on just a moment here. Big double power bomb from Zero Lopez and Sterling Thomas. Ooh, Insegiri sidestepped by Kurt London. Kurt London just too quick, too experienced. Looks like Zero gonna elect to try and slow Kurt London down. Zero, of course, known as the man that is just has every tool at his disposal. Can come at you just a million different ways, but right now, Kurt London not letting him do it anyway. And looks like we are back at the matchup that started it all in tonight's contest as Sterling slugging it out with Solarion, and that is not a place you want to be if you are Kurt London's protege. Going for that patented Rosala elbow drop doesn't find its mark as Solarion scrambling to his feet. And right now, Solarion struggling to get things going. It looks like Sterling had a moment on the apron to adjust. It has made himself just extremely difficult for Solarion to deal with. Hold on, big sandwich Insegiri as both Solarion and London meeting at the head of one Sterling Thomas. Looks like Sterling gonna be going back into his own corner. Tornad kick doesn't quite find its mark, and it will not the second time either. Zero gonna try and bring this fight back into his own corner if he is able to do so. Kurt London now going for that flying head scissors of his own, but do not count out the experience of 1-0 Lopez either. He has been competing for Blake's House Professional Wrestling since this brand's inception, and he is the mystery champion. He will fight anyone, anywhere, at any time. But, like, again, we're gonna get two tags here. Solarion now trying to get the advantage over Sterling once again, shooting himself into the ropes and a big flipping senton center of the ring. Like that is going to clear that orange Gatorade apron and give Sterling an opportunity. It looks like Sterling going to be going back to his own corner, create another two-on-one situation and another big double power bomb. Solarion just hold on a second, big sharpshooter now, but Zero able to power out of that hold. Fired into that corner, misses with the Enziguri, and now Zero just in total control over Mr. Five Star. Zero going for that mount tackle, unable to find it, but Solarion able to fire Zero into that corner, goes for it a second time, but big drop kick from Zero Lopez, and it's looking like this Lopez and Sterling team, the more organized tag team. Despite that, do not count out the savviness. Do not count out the athleticism of Kurt London. Hold on. Sterling, that patented Warzala elbow drop is laid into the back of Kurt London, but Kurt London, shotgun drop kick right to the face. Kurt London looking to turn up the heat on Sterling Thomas, and Sterling going to be going back into his own corner, and it looks like London will be doing the same. Big shining knee right to the jaw, taking a page out of Solarion's own book here. You got to figure he is not going to take kindly to that. A Zero fired into that corner turnbuckle, and hold on just a moment here. Oh my god, just absolutely devastating knee strike from Mr. Five Star. As Zero Lopez trapped on that middle rope. And that was the same knees that put Jordan on the shelf. And hold on, looks like Zero gonna be sending Solarion to the outside. And Rada quickly losing control of this match as Sterling giant chokeslam on the outside. God, just the chaos in and around the ring here. Big double drop kick from Zero and Sterling. And a colossal lariat from Sterling, and Solarion has got to be feeling it here. Looks like this is gonna clear out both aprons. Zero getting there a little bit before Kurt London is able to do so. And again, that just speaks to the experience of these two working together as a team. Doesn't seem as though Solarion and London are quite in sync yet. Hold on a second, Kurt London. Of course, the man that has never seen a spotlight he is not one to stand under. Just delivering a absolutely gorgeous series of kicks, and now again trading blows with Sterling. And is such a dangerous proposition. Those hands of Sterling, so very heavy, so very dangerous, but hold on. It's like Kurt London looking to hit that flaming 151. He thinks it's about time, but Sterling knows just how dangerous Kurt London is when he's on that top turnbuckle and is able to get back to his own corner. Zero flashing elbow right into the throat, and hold on, big DDT from Kurt London, and Kurt London gonna go back to his own corner, bring a fresh Mr. Five Star into this match. Tornad kick does not connect. Swinging neckbreaker from Zero will. Twisting face buster from Solarion, and on back switch, but Solarion just a little bit too quick for Zero, and I know he is not used to that. He is not used to being at a disadvantage when it comes to speed and agility, but hold on a second. Big dive kick off the top, buries a boot in the back of the head of Mr. Five Star, and Mr. Five Star gonna respond back with two boots to the chest as he gets free to his own corner. And a leapfrog into a bulldog and planting Zero's face into the mat. And Kurt London getting himself fired up. Springboard body press, but foot on the bottom rope will protect Zero Lopez. Big double drop kick from Sterling and Zero. And again, this team just so much more in sync. And oh my God! Big DDT from Kurt London here. And once again, gonna be setting up for that finishing combination, looking for the flaming 151. He's going up top and it connects. Cover 1-2-0, able to make the save at a critical moment. Kurt London getting himself fired up, and it looks like gonna bring Solarion into this match here. As a big destroyer center of the ring, and that's gonna set up Mr. Five Star for a star shot center of the ring. Goes for the cover. 1-2-0 again, making a save at a critical moment. And Zero hitting a destroyer of his own of the Puerto Rican variety. But it is absolutely anybody's match here. Sterling in trouble in that chin lock here, but on Destino from Zero Lopez, and it's like Sterling was setting up for something into the corner, but Solarion able to escape as an Ushigaroshi just planting Solarion right onto the knee, and Zero looks like he's going high risk. Big 450 splash, cover 2, and a 3-count fall. Kurt London just a little bit too late to save Solarion. And really, the story of that match, the more organized, the more the team that was on the same page coming out victorious in this contest. And yeah, that's that big dive kick, like, just such a brutal looking animation. Also, GK, I did notice you with that Twitch Prime sub. Very much appreciate it, and appreciate you hanging out in the chat as well, Zo. But, yeah, you will almost certainly be seeing more of those tonight, and yeah, credit to GK, like, Solarion and London don't put on bad matches. And certainly not going to undersell my own shit. Like, I think Sterling and Zero, pretty fun to watch as well. But we're gonna keep things rolling here. Gonna keep this interstable action going as Floyd Bartholomew now. Going to be taking on Robert Walsh. Of course, John Newton is going to be in tonight's main event, so the enforcer of Baby Man gonna have to take out his aggression on somebody else tonight. Looks like he has selected the only Robert Walsh to be his opponent. And that match, it's right now. Certainly a surprise when Bartholomew aligned himself with that Mixed Wrestling Organization champion, Baby Man, acting as his enforcer, but Newton and Walsh picking up a clutch victory over these two in tag team action last week. This will be Bartholomew's shot at redemption, and again, Bartholomew so effective at utilizing his weight, making himself so difficult to move around the ring as he blocks that vertical suplex. And Robert Walsh gonna have to think about how he challenges Bartholomew over the course of this match. Robert Walsh busted open, but Robert Walsh certainly experienced in the avenue of hardcore wrestling. I can't imagine that is going to slow him down one bit as he continues to swing wildly with those left and right hands and continues to keep the pressure on the big man, Floyd Bartholomew. Right now, Bartholomew and Walsh just swinging for the fences on one another. Bartholomew coming out on top in this exchange. As I said earlier, Bartholomew so effective at using his weight to keep himself from being moved around the ring, but also so effective at using his weight to quite literally crush the bodies and the spirits of his opponents. And that sit-out, sit-down maneuver, absolutely emblematic of that strategy. But hold on, series of heavy left hands from Robert Walsh now. Walsh trying to battle back and get himself back into this match, and again firing Bartholomew into that corner turnbuckle. Bartholomew pulling out another foreign object, and he seems to take exception to the warning from Harada here. Big knee to the gut, firing himself out of that Irish whip, and see Robert Walsh springing up to his feet. He knows how dangerous Bartholomew is when you are laid out on the mat. Comes that big worm chop coming from Big Nasty himself, Floyd Bartholomew, as a forearm just collides with the throat of Robert Walsh, and that could be it right there. You can see the only Robert lying in a pool of his own blood and the enforcer of Babyman picking up a victory in decisive fashion, looking to send a message to the team that would challenge for Babyman's championship. So I figured it out last week why that is. You must have not been in the chat when we were talking about it. So Maglo has the hard body perk, which means if you aren't using a big move, it's much more difficult to pin him. And because Floyd's two match ending maneuvers is the hip drop and the elbow drop, those aren't considered big moves by the game. So he is more likely to kick out of those. So, and it's also why he went 30 minutes with Warzala, who also is tuned to win in 6 minutes or lose in 8. So it just so happened to be that fighting style ran into a special ability that, depending on your point of view, is really good or really bad to run into. Because, I mean, it made both matches really exciting, but it also kind of exposes some flaws in those characters' design. But, yeah, I mean, shit. I've been playing this game since Early Access in 2017, and I'm still learning shit about it. So, there's a lot of stuff in this game, and barely any tutorialization, and the largest communities for this game do not speak English. So, you're just going to continue learning about this game for many years to come, I'm sure. Yeah, if we want to figure out a way to tune Bartholomew so, like, he doesn't squash as much, and then also can still be more competitive against Hardbody, like, we can do that. I mean, that might not be a bad idea, considering he's kind of tuned. It's kind of how I have Warzala tuned, is, like, he wins in 6 or he loses in 8 is kind of how I've got Warzala set up. Because, like, yeah, he's supposed to be a big man that imposes his will on his opponents, and if he's unable to do that, then his opponents catch up to him. So that might not be a bad place to start with the retune of Bartholomew. But we're getting a little bit in the weeds right now. We can, of course, always discuss this on the post show, because right now we have a battle royal to set up, and as I said at the open of tonight's program, Maglo is conspicuously absent from this week's program, and DJ Dix not only holding court in the open challenge, but has demanded 3 of his guys as the challengers for the King of Fighters television title tonight. But before we get to that match, we need to figure out who is competing in this 8-man over-the-top rope battle royal to challenge DJ Dix. Let me see. I don't think I have either. Frank is booked tonight. He is going to be in singles action with Bobby Goodwin. However, I can put Dan Ramadan in, as he is not booked tonight. I can do Savio Vega. Let's see. Let me get Remedin first. I don't think I do. I do not. And I probably wouldn't have him in 2000s either, yeah. That actually would not be a bad pick to get. Yeah, Savio Vega, of course, the man that Steve Austin... Oh, definitely. Like, Steve Austin, like, continually gives credit to getting him back into ring shape by working just... like, dark matches with him, like, week in and week out. When he came back from his, injury. Nick Vadala, we can do that. See, I'll put me in because I was in last week. Actually, no, I'm not. I've got a different idea for that tonight. I'll put Matt in. Mummy. No, one of my friends made this Mecha Mummy edit, and now they're gonna. Now that the Movecraft exists, you could potentially have like actual Mecha Mummy comedy spots. Man, I've seen some wild shit with the Movecraft DLC, like actual Ultimate Muscle moves and like actual like Mortal Kombat moves. It is, for sure. I haven't really played around with it too much, but it is cool seeing all the shit people have built in it so far. I can definitely do Ultimo Dragon. I probably have him in, if he's not in WCW, I probably have him in All Japan. Because that's where, like, if I'm not sure where you worked, you are hanging out there. Let's see. Highly likely. Yep, Ultimo Dragon. Actually, I wouldn't mind here. Saw another name. Let's see. So we kind of did this already. But I will... Ooh, actually don't hate Onita either. Cyborg, I can do that. Actually, that would be one hell of a matchup, the Cyborg versus DJ Dix. But, like, I distinctly remember a few... Probably a little over a month ago now. It was just, like, the Legends of Japanese Wrestling. But I don't think I had a Super Delphin in my save at the time. So we'll get him in there with Ultimo. But that is going to be... And honestly, like I said, Onita wouldn't be a bad pick there either. But, I mean, we do one of these every week, so we can always get through more guys later. So we now have the eight names that could potentially face DJ Dix later on tonight's program. So let's go ahead and get into the match right now. Just hold on, the Cyborg already eliminated by Super Delphin, as is Mecha Mummy. Delphin is coming here to win tonight. And two eliminations in less than a minute. But as I said, nothing short of greatness when you have two legends such as Delphin and Ultimo Dragon in the ring. But hold on, Savio Vega eliminating Matt Knapp as well, and the journey of Matt Knapp is a tragic one, as he is always so close. He gets opportunity after opportunity, but never quite able to close the deal. This match would have given him a shot at the semi-main event on tonight's program, but he's going to have to wait as Delphin and Dragon battle it out. No, Dan Rambodin is going to cut in as Savio Vega and Vadala slug it out now. Vadala fired into the ropes, but the chaos of this match, just too much to keep track of. Ramon looking to just impose his will on Dragon, but again, just too many bodies in the ring to be able to focus on one person. Big reverse DDT from Ramon, and now Dan Ramon and Vadala battling it out. And these men not playing favorites, as Dan Ramon going to just slug it out with the boss of his own stable. And that's how it has to be here in Blake's House Professional Wrestling.
Give up.
Respect the sanctity of this 20 by 20 squared circle. And hold on, Delphin now. Big backbreaker to Ramadan and Savio Vega. Sidewalk slam here, and there's just so many bodies flying around and so very close to the ropes. An elimination could happen at any moment. Big jawbreaker from Delphin, and absolutely gorgeous suplex as Ramadan now unable to stick to one dance partner at a time, and nearly getting an elimination on Ultimo Dragon, but he was able to get a hand on that top rope, protect himself from elimination as Savio Vega applies that chin lock, trying to slow this match down a little bit.
Give up.
But that is going to be very difficult with everyone in the ring willing to turn up the heat as this match continues. And hold on, Dragon fired into that corner turnbuckle, but nobody able to capitalize. Hold on, flash roll-up cover, no. Hand on the bottom rope. And this match will continue.
Give up.
As Nick Vadala showcasing an amazing display of power. He's able to put a man the size of Dan Ramadan into that giant swing. On series, 1, 2, 3 European uppercuts. Cover 1, 2, but only gets 2. Big Pele kick from Vadala, but...
Give up!
Oh my god, absolutely devastating powerbomb, but Nick now Tiger Driver of his own, but neither able to get that pinfall victory. Dan Ramadan getting absolutely amped, but Savio Vega gonna cool him off, pulling Ultimo Dragon away from that top rope there.
Give up. Give up.
Savio Vega possibly going to eliminate. Yes, and he does. Ultimo Dragon tumbling out of the ring. Savio Vega eliminated by Delphin, and we are down 2-3. And just as we were at the start of this program, Nick's wrestling organization looking to showcase their supremacy as a stable. And they would absolutely do so if they were to pick up a victory over DJ Dix. Hold on. Avalanche powerbomb 2 and only 2.
Yeah.
That big Steel City slam from Dan Ramadan, but Ramadan eliminated by Delphin. Delphin now with 4 eliminations tonight. But hold on, big Tiger Driver cover 1, 2, and 3 count fall. Vadala showcasing. You don't need the most eliminations. You need the last elimination. As he comes out on top in this contest and earns himself a shot at DJ Dix, the Doctor, Darkness. But as I said just a few moments ago, DJ Dix politicking a little bit. As we are going to see a new stable of fighters under the DJ Dix banner coming in to challenge for that KOF television title. And that match, let's see here, make sure the rules are all good. And that match, it's right now. Men calling themselves the Bookoo Fighters. Dougal, the kickboxer. Monty, the submission specialist in purple. And Dick Boss, the big man in white. Challenging for the King of Fighters television title. Thank you. Hans Hurtem, not intimidated at all by Dougal's forearm smash, getting a big chop of his own to start this contest off. And that is going to have to be your strategy against an elite striker like Dougal. But looks like this team going to change their game plan a little bit. Looks like bringing Monty in early now. But this Knicks wrestling organization team making a switch of their own. Idolo, the elite athlete of Knicks wrestling organization, going for an early cover one, but only one. Both teams tagging frequently as Dick Boss inserted into this match.
Not so fast!
And it is such a dangerous proposition to go for that mount tackle on a man like Devon Ramos, the world's tallest cruiserweight. His submission skills are second to none. But Dick Boss looking to challenge that, and I'm certain Monty will as well. He picks the leg and goes for that knee bar, but Dick Boss able to escape, and looks like he's going to be going back into his own corner. And it looks like we are not going to be getting the matchup of submission specialist versus submission specialist, as Dougal going to be going head-to-head with Ramos. Lugging it out with the tallest cruiserweight, but trying to compete against a kickboxer in a strike exchange is a foolhardy endeavor at best, but it looks like Dougal having these two-on-one situation, trying to avoid that hold-on ripcord and chop to the chest. Absolutely titanic from Hans Hurtem. Now this Knicks wrestling organization team in the driver's seat here. As Hurtem goes for the cover on Dick Boss, gets a one, but only a one. Dick Boss on top here. Big boy senton is Boss throwing his weight around the ring. Like Devon Ramos coming back into this contest. On suplex is blocked, and a suplex of his own delivered from Dick Boss, but Ramos looking to get things going here already, targeting the knees of the big man. And that is going to send Dick Boss to his own corner, and it is Monty and Devon Ramos in the ring. Submission specialist versus submission specialist. And we're gonna have to see exactly how this matchup plays out. Ramos now gaining the upper hand briefly here. Picks the leg. Goes for a moonsault press to start things off, and it looks like he's not taking Monty seriously. And that could prove to be a mistake, as Monty already beginning his assault on the arms of Ramos. Looks like Monty targeting the legs of Idolo, trying to take away the elite athlete's speed, but like this Knicks wrestling organization team again going back to this Monty Ramos matchup. And hold on a second, flipping through, and a absolutely gorgeous flying head scissors. Series of elbow smashes, and it's like Monty gonna be bringing Dick Boss back into this match, but again, picking the leg, and again, targeting the legs of the big man. And
10 minutes gone.
And Ramos, so dangerous. A man that is responsible for so many of this team's eliminations in these matchups. His submission skills are absolutely deadly, as Dick Voss has been finding out thus far. Hold on. Rolling scarf hold, but foot on the bottom rope will force him to break that up. Throwing a wild haymaker, doesn't quite find its mark. Looks like Dick Voss bringing Monty back into this match. In the leg. Hans Hurtem, and again, continuing to target that leg.
Not so fast.
Hans Hurtem showing off for the fans a little bit. And as I said, this really feels like this Knicks wrestling organization stable looking to send a message to the Blake's House locker room. Barely able to sneak in that float over DDT. Hold on. Looks like Monty going to be challenging the grappling skills of Devon Ramos, and that is exactly what I was expecting from this matchup, but hold on just a second here. Big STO and sweep from Monty, and now Dougal doing the same, but not faring as well against an elite grappler such as Devon Ramos. But that kick to the chest, certainly effective. I don't care what your strategy is, and hold on. Big rolling scarf hold from Ramos, trying to choke the life out of Dougal. Now it is Idolo going head to head with Dougal. Forearm smash to stomach kick, but Dougal coming out on top in that exchange. And now a series of elbow smashes from this kickboxer. And he's going high risk. Big knee drop off the top, and Dougal is on fire. And that is going to clear out both aprons. And Hans Hurtem delivering a series of kicks to the chest of his own. As you can tell, that might have woken this Knicks wrestling organization team up a little bit. Big float over DDT. Yeah. Yeah. And locking on that patented cross arm breaker, but this Knicks wrestling organization team clearing their apron so quickly. And again, Monty continuing to target the arms of Hans Hurtem. Big drop kick to the back of the head, and Hans Hurtem going back into his own corner. And Hans Hurtem picking the leg and setting up Ramos perfectly if he wants to continue that onslaught. And missing that wheel kick, going to give Monty an opportunity to get to his own corner. And hold on just a moment here. What the hell is Dick Voss doing up top? Big, big body drop, but Ramos able to escape the pressure. And here it is, Monty looking to outmaneuver Ramos. Able to escape Monty for just a little bit longer, but Monty is not finished with this team, not by a long shot, but Monty fired to the outside, and that's going to clear out this orange Gatorade corner. This Knicks wrestling organization team taking advantage of Monty on the outside. And high and low, Monty trapped in the unblockable. But Monty able to get back into the ring, escapes the leaping cutter, and that has put Hans Hurtem in a very dangerous position. But hold on, looks like his team bringing Dick Boss into the ring. Hold on, cover out of nowhere. Oh, but foot on the bottom rope. And Dick Boss now in control. But a leaping brainbuster, creating an opportunity for Hans Hurtem to get back into his own corner and bringing a fresh Idolo into this match. Sandwich Insigiri absolutely crushing the skull of Dick Boss, and again, this team continuing to target the legs of the big man. And big destroyer from Idolo, and Idolo doesn't seem to be finished with the Boss, but oh my god, absolutely devastating power slam, but Hans Hurtem able to make the save at a crucial moment. Monty in complete control right now as a rolling armbar. This could be it. No. Hold on. Yes. That is the first elimination for this team, and it looks like Monty wants to keep going. And it is so very rare for this Knicks wrestling organization team to be a man down in these battle or in these six-man tag matches. But they have Hans Hurtem, an elite technician that can pick up a pinfall at any moment. And the only man to ever submit Ramon on Blake's House Television. This team is not out by any stretch of the imagination. But right now, Monty bringing Dougal into this match. And Hans Hurtem bringing in Devon Ramos now. As it is going to be striking versus grappling, a battle as old as time. But Dougal coming out on top in this first exchange. And that big Tony Jaa knee strike, but Ramos scrambles to his feet immediately. And now beginning to torture the arms of Dougal, but this is where the numbers game starts to come into play. Big flying wheel kick. And Dougal is getting hyped up here. Hold on. Northern Lights right into a cross arm breaker, and Monty positively offended at the prospect of one of his opponents delivering that cross arm breaker, but Dougal unable to stop Ramos from getting to his own corner. And Dougal fired into the outside, but that is going to create a two-on-one situation inside the ring. And two bodies just meeting at Hans Hurtem while Ramos strangles Dougal on the outside. 15. And Harada's 16. Count is at 16 as a big cross chop collides with Hans Hurtem, and Dougal trying to get back to his own corner. He is able to do so, but Hurtem has picked up a ton of momentum here as Dougal was absolutely punished on the outside by Ramos. On the subject of momentum, we have once again grappler versus grappler, and hold on, big power bomb and cutter combination, and Ramos looking to submit Monty, but he's unable to do so. Continuing to target the limbs of Monty, and you've got to figure this matchup cannot end in pinfall. One of these two men will have to submit the other, but right now Dick Boss doesn't seem too interested in finding out who that's going to be as he continues to apply punishment to Devon Ramos. Big sidewalk slam, but it is... Oh my god. Two power slam, but unable to get the third. As Ramos coming in to make the save at a critical moment. So Dick Boss will just go for it a second time. Big power slam, but unable to capitalize. And Dougal has set Dick Boss up with excellent position here, but no, it looks like he's going to bring Monty back into this match. Big lift and drop. And Monty able to get out of the vortex, but not able to escape the punishing blows. And hold on, going for a cover here. This could be it. One, two, three count fall. We are back to 2-on-2, and it looks like it is Dougal going head to head with Hans Hurtem. Suplex to the outside, and that's going to clear out both aprons now. It is absolutely anybody's match here. But Dougal trapped on the outside for the time being, but hold on just a minute here. Could be setting up for that blistering Tony John knee strike. That could be it. Cover. One, two, three count fall. And Hans Hurtem all alone against Dick Boss and Dougal. On another leaping brain buster, and that is going to bring in Dick Boss. But too close to that blue Gatorade corner, and that's going to create an opportunity. Hold on, another leaping brain buster. And Dick Boss is in trouble. Big leaping cutter as well, but Dick Boss back up to his feet. But Hans Hurtem so effective. This is that patented Knicks Wrestling Organization tag team strategy, isolating the team from their own corner. Even when you are down to the last man, there is such an advantage of being far away from the opposing team's corner. Hold on just a moment here. Big double powerbomb, absolutely flattening Hans Hurtem. And there's that Tony John knee strike. And if Dougal goes for the cover here, that's got to be it. Cover. One, two, three count fall. And despite the supremacy that this Knicks Wrestling Organization stable has put on display over the course of tonight's program, the reign of this Knicks Wrestling Organization Trios team has finally come to an end, and it is from what DJ Dix is calling the Bookoo Fighters. Dougal, Dick Boss, and Monty are your new King of Fighters television champions. Yeah, honestly, that match was super competitive the whole way through. I kind of wish we got to see more of Monty versus Ramos, because that is absolutely the matchup I envisioned as being, like, the exciting matchup between these two teams. But that doesn't mean that eventually when this team has to drop the title, those two can't just fight each other later. But yeah, was a legit good match. Yeah, because, I mean, submission specialist versus submission specialist, and could also just do our first ever submission match. It's fucked up, too, because I think the one time it happened, he wasn't the legal man or something stupid like that. Because I know we've seen it, it just didn't do anything. But yeah, like, the what I'm thinking here is Monty versus Ramos in a submission match. Sounds like a pretty good matchup, but that'll have to wait a little bit, as we've still got a lot of show to get through tonight. Depends on whether or not this team still has the Trios title then. Although, I suppose there's no rules that people can't do double duty. That happens sometimes on this show. Sometimes, even on purpose. But as we continue to make our way towards this Knicks Wrestling Organization pay-per-view, we have Frank Vista, a man challenging for Bobby Goodwin's Tag Team Championship. And right now, he has got an opportunity to send a message to one half of the Tag Team Champions. And we will have to see if he is able to do so right now. Got to believe that Frank Vista asked for this match specifically because he wants to send a message to Bobby Goodwin that I can out-wrestle you. Of course, Bobby Goodwin, the more technically savvy member of the Goodwin brothers. Of course, Billy Goodwin, just a spectacular athlete, so fast, so agile, but the submission skills of Bobby Goodwin are nothing short of spectacular. Frank Vista, looking to send a message that he is not intimidated in a one-on-one contest. But right now, Bobby Goodwin putting those submission skills to good use, trying to grind it out, take away the limbs of Frank Vista piece by piece. Got to wonder just how much Bobby Goodwin, oh my God, big mount tackle, but Bobby reversing it into that pinning predicament, but Vista getting a shoulder off the mat immediately before Harada even able to get a count of one. And again, Goodwin just trying to pick apart the arms and legs, any exposed surface that Goodwin is able to get a hand on. He is doing so. But Vista, of course, a technician. Known as the toolbox, as in he has got every single tool and then some. Going for that mount tackle time and time again, but Goodwin just too savvy in the ring. Able to get a foot on the bottom rope, and this match will continue. Long suplex blocked, and suplex from Bobby Goodwin, and Frank Vista's plan was to send a message. It is in the early stages of backfire thus far. You can see the frustration beginning to set in on Vista as he delivers a series of mounted punches and another series of punches to the jaw of Bobby Goodwin. Something seems to have woken up in Frank Vista as he is starting to turn on the pressure here, but big double arm bar from Bobby Goodwin, and Bobby Goodwin just a catch as catch can specialist. Whatever Vista is giving him, he is quite literally grabbing a hold of, and hold on just a minute here. Oh my God! German suplex into that top turnbuckle, absolutely devastating, but Goodwin fighting his way back to his feet and keeping up with that game plan that has got him to the dance. And absolutely huge Olympic style slam, but one reversal from Goodwin again, cover one, but only one. Frank Vista has got a lot more left in the tank than that, my friend, but Goodwin looking to extinguish that and more, and again applying that giant swing. TKO from Goodwin, and both men down, but Vista is to his feet first, but it seems to be on instinct alone, as he was entirely unprepared for Goodwin. Hold on, what the hell is Goodwin setting up for here? Absolutely picture perfect suplex. Is that going to be enough? No, Goodwin doesn't seem to think so. 10 minutes gone. And Bobby Goodwin rolling out of the ring just as Frank Vista starting to apply some pressure. Bobby Goodwin just leaving the ring, forcing him to cool off a little bit. Said these Knicks wrestling organization teams, oh my God, belly to back overhead suplex, and looks like he's going to send another one. Cover one, two. Vista barely able to kick out of that absolutely monstrous head drop, but Vista starting things off here. Another series of suplexes. Planting Goodwin into the mat. Looks like he was setting up for a backdrop of some sort, but was denied the opportunity. And Bobby Goodwin now back in the driver's seat. Loving lariat, but Vista fighting his way back to his feet. Another big TKO, but both men down. Going for another German suplex, but this time Bobby Goodwin had it scouted. Another Olympic style slam, and this could be it. No, reverses into that pinning predicament. Cover two and three count fall. And Bobby Goodwin just a little bit too crafty for Frank Vista. Frank Vista overextended himself just a little bit too much. And the wily veteran that is Bobby Goodwin, able to sneak that pinning predicament by him. You've got to figure, if you are Frank Vista, you are not going to let that happen twice. Hey, how you doing, Rayman? And GK, I can check that before the post show. Gotta imagine it's pretty, like, it's centered around the 20s, but certainly can be looked at during the post show. But Rayman, appreciate you coming by again. If you are just tuning in, and this is not me in character, this is me legitimately saying you missed some absolutely wild matches. But we still got a couple more for you tonight, so let's keep this show rolling here. If you were tuned in last week, you saw Ramon fold Eric Alpizar up like an old wallet with that absolutely devastating Dr. Bomb. Well, this time Alpizar getting a chance at revenge in singles action. And that match is going to be right now. Chop from Ramon, and both of these men, of course, veterans of that mixed martial arts division, but we are settling this in the squared circle. But you got to figure the educated feet of Alpizar going to come into play in this match, and Alpizar trying to measure his distance, create opportunities for those big kicks of his, but Ramon gonna make that very difficult. He wants to keep the pressure up over the course of this match. Goes for a cover, but not even getting one. And then drop. This is quite personal for Alpizar. While he is certainly the type to hold grudges, I think this is more a matter of pride, as he was absolutely shown up last week. He wants an opportunity for redemption as he connects with that low roundhouse, taking the legs out from underneath the legs of Ramon, and Alpizar continuing to add fuel to the fire. Swinging those educated feet at Ramon, burying boots right to the stomach. But Ramon fighting back with those sledgehammer-like hands of his own. And connecting with that rolling knee bar. Just being submitted by Ramos so many weeks back. Also a point of pride for Ramon, as he's adapted his game plan a little bit. More submission focused, but right now the man in front of you is Eric Alpizar, and he has just planted him to the mat with that pile driver.
5 minutes gone.
Big low roundhouse. Alpizar delivering a series of mounted punches, but second, and Ramon again just applying these submission holds, trying to wear Alpizar down, take the power away from those legendary legs of Quiraga. Knee to the gut, goes for a cover, but only gets a count of two. And again, tangling Alpizar's legs up in this hold here, but Alpizar is the man to his feet first and goes for a cover, possibly sensing blood in the water. Being said, of course, Ramon, his toughness is well known in the Blake's House wrestling world. This man tougher than a $2 steak, but the striking ability of Alpizar absolutely more than capable of wearing this man down.
Hey-ya!
Big back fist, absolutely flooring Ramon now and going back to that knee bar. And you can see Ramon wearing knee pads now. That new since his struggle with Devon Ramos, possibly looking to protect those legs a little bit further. Hold on, big reverse choke slam from Alpizar, and Alpizar is not yet finished with Ramon running the ropes, and big STO, and transitions right back into that knee bar. And I may have spoke too soon when I said this wasn't personal for Alpizar. You can see he's trying to get under the skin of Ramon. Continuing to work the legs and kind of add injury to insult on that first submission loss.
10 minutes gone.
Right now, Ramon doing exactly what he always does. Man, it continues to get back to his feet no matter the odds against him, but Alpizar intends to make that very difficult. Ooh, measuring that distance with that palm strike so effectively. And again, going back to that pile driver. continuing to drop Alpizar on his neck, and Alpizar springing up to his feet before, hold on, series of body blows. I figure Alpizar looking for another one of those big kicks, but Ramon just too fast. Able to get his guard up at a critical moment, and absolutely picture-perfect dropkick, but Alpizar is to his feet first and delivers another patented reverse chokeslam. Hold on, Alpizar going up top. Big diving elbow buried into the back of Ramon, and he's going to take a moment to breathe. Ramon getting back up to his feet. Misses with that kick, but able to connect with that one, and now Alpizar and Ramon slugging it out. But Ramon, the legendary toughness of Ramon coming out victorious in that exchange. It's the unstoppable force and the immovable object. But the immovable object will prevail in this instance. And Ramon again going for that rolling knee bar. Spoke after that KOF TV title match that we may be seeing Blake's House first ever submission match in the near future, but it looks like Ramon and Alpizar intend to beat us to that milestone, as these two men are bound and determined to submit one another on tonight's contest. Running the width of the ring and big cross chop, but Ramon doesn't seem to be finished with Alpizar just yet. He has done the deal. Nobody kicks out of the Falcon Arrow cover two, but Alpizar somehow, some way, able to escape, but expending all of his energy in the process. Hold on, knee bar out of nowhere, but Alpizar hanging on somehow, some way, will not be submitted. Big knee to the gut, and Alpizar now locking on a hold of his own. And big tornad kick from Alpizar, but Alpizar starting to run out of gas. He is running into the wall that is Ramon. Alpizar trying to get the crowd on his side. Big mount tackle, but guillotine choke from Ramon, but a hand on the bottom rope will save Alpizar here. Alpizar trying to get the crowd on his side, and Ibar once again starting to cheer for Alpizar, and he is going to need it as he is trapped in another knee bar. Able to escape that chop here, and Alpizar now back in the driver's seat with the crowd behind him as he delivers another STO, but Ramon back to his feet once again. Big boot to the head, but once again, I figure Alpizar is looking for that sure killing blow, that strike combination that he knows will keep Ramon down. Big shoulder block from Ramon now. Hold on, knee bar once again, but Alpizar saved by that bottom rope. Once again, just slamming Alpizar to the mat, and he rolls out of the ring to get a moment to breathe. Big reverse choke slam, but Alpizar not yet finished as these two men slug it out.
That could be the difference maker there. No, Alpizar not going for the cover.
Yeah.
That tornad kick. Hold on, one-winged angel cover, two, three count fall. And Ramon picking up the victory over Alpizar 2 weeks in a row. Alpizar looking for a shot at redemption, but there was none to be found this week. It's Ramon picking up the victory in tonight's contest. I'm also going to have to check Alpizar's priority attacks, because I know he is set to pin off more than just his finishing strike combination, but he did not attempt any pinfalls at the close of that match, and that was the second time that we've seen that. So I'm wondering if I accidentally changed the AI for the pro wrestling version of Alpizar. Because the MMA version, obviously, like, he is a pure striker. But the pro wrestling version should have more stuff that goes into pinfalls, but that is clearly not the case right now. Stuff to look at later, of course, because we still got a couple matches left on tonight's show, so let's go ahead and get into DJ Dix holding court in a Blake's House ring in an official capacity. We have just seen DJ Dix's stable, the Bookoo Fighters, finally unseat the Knicks Wrestling Organization Trios team that had held the KOF TV title with a vice-like grip. But the boss of the Knicks Wrestling Organization stable getting an opportunity to take on DJ Dix himself. And that match is next. DJ Dix wasting no time getting to the ring. Showing exactly how much respect he has for Nick Vadala or the Knicks Wrestling Organization. But we will have to see if Nick is able to turn that around on DJ Dix. Flex is blocked, and DJ Dix planting Vadala to the mat, but Vadala scrambles to his feet. Flex is reversed, and a backbreaker from Vadala, and they're going to that crossface chicken wing, but DJ Dix able to escape. Looks like Nick Vadala was willing to take this to the outside, but DJ Dix wants to have this fight inside a 20 by 20. He blocks that kick and delivers a kick of his own. God, chaos theory from Vadala gets a count of one on the doctor. Oh! Dragon screw leg whip, and the technical prowess of Vadala on display here, and he is going to need every last ounce of his technical ability to put away the monster that is DJ Dix. And DJ Dix responding back to Vidal's giant swing with a giant swing of his own. Two can absolutely play at that game, but Vadala still one step ahead of DJ Dix, at least for the time being. Hold on, DJ Dix going high risk. And tries to drive an elbow into the heart of Vadala, but Vadala rolling out of the way. DJ Dix holding on to that drop kick for several minutes, but Vadala once again able to escape that danger as well. Big sharpshooter, and DJ Dix in a dangerous spot. Hold on, Vadala going for that tiger driver, but DJ Dix has blocked it. Big running European uppercut, and Vadala in control right now. DJ Dix looking to slow this man down. Right now, these two men just struggling for supremacy over the course of this contest. As again, Vadala applying that crossface chicken wing, trying to choke the life out of DJ Dix. On cover once again, one, two, but only gets two. DJ Dix now lifting and dropping Vadala, and gonna keep up the pressure, flipping Big Boy into the center of the ring. Big double arm DDT from Vadala, and DJ Dix is on the ropes here. Suplex reverse, but DJ Dix not allowing Vadala to take his back as he buries an elbow into the neck of Nick Vadala and gets another shot with that suplex and slamming him into the ring and applying that vice-like grip to the face of Nick Vadala, and Vadala fighting his way out of the hole. Big Kami Goye, but DJ Dix scrambling back to his feet. Going out, goes for a cover once again, too. DJ Dix narrowly able to escape. On lift and drop from DJ Dix, and both men getting to their feet at nearly the same time. And hold on a second, muscle buster! Cover one, two, but only gets two. So here is another one for good measure. That one getting a near fall. Nick's hand getting off the mat at just the last possible moment. And a slight miscalculation could have cost DJ Dix greatly here. Another lift and then drop, and DJ Dix back in the driver's seat as he applies that iron claw and digging into the skin of the forehead of Nick Vadala here. Nick has been busted open, and the landscape of this match has just changed. It's like Nick is going high risk, and big twisting 450, but big lariat, and it looks like he's setting up for another one. And it will connect. Cover one, two, is this it? Three, count, fall. And Nick Vadala shocking the world, picking up the victory over DJ Dix. His team may have lost the battle, but at least tonight he has won the war against the doctor. again, this might be something. We might be building some stuff here. But we, of course, have one more match. Don't hate that either. Could have a real, like, stable battle. And it is for the number one contenders spots of the Knicks Wrestling Organization Championship. Let's see here. This is very convenient because it's already on the stable that I need them to be on. This is going to be Fatal 4-Way. First fall to the finish. The winner of this match will get a shot at Baby Man's Championship at the Knicks Wrestling Organization special events. Date to be determined, because I'm not sure if I'm going to have a stream on 4th of July weekend. Probably will, but I've still got one more loose end I want to tie up before we have that show, so don't want to commit to a date just yet, but we'll know for sure next week when that program's going to be. But right now, we've got a main event. Brad Chad, Dick Bruiser, David Clement, and John Newton all vying for a title shot of Knicks Wrestling Organization Gold. And that match is right now.
Fight!
This Fatal 4-Way, it's gonna be so very difficult. Particularly with the high-octane style of Clement and Newton. As they are going to ensure the pace of this match is just absolutely blistering, but you cannot count out too big, too strong, too tough Dick Bruiser. And Brad Chad, putting on an instant classic with Orlando Nunez last week, earning the respect of both major stables, the Blake's House and Knicks Wrestling Organization. Oh my God! The raw lifting ability of Brad Chad, absolutely phenomenal. Couldn't even begin to tell you who to keep your eyes on in this match. All four men want a shot at the top. Hold on, cover, but put in the middle rope. Gonna take more than that, Brad Chad, but Brad Chad more than willing to give more as he delivers that airplane spin. Brad Chad, the ultimate opportunist in this match. Trying to sneak a cover in on anyone he is able to do so on. Hold on. That Smith Especial, but hand on the bottom rope. Will protect John Newton for just a little bit longer.
Feel the power.
Minutes gone.
Give
mount tackle from Brad Chad, and it's like Brad Chad is going to be the man to watch tonight as he looks positively motivated.
Feel the power.
He has been giving everything he's got in this match and then some, but on David getting a cover on Newton, but only getting a count of one.
Give up.
Hold on, package. Pile driver. Goes for a cover, but foot in the bottom rope. Looks like all four men changing dance partners here. As Brad Chad now slugging it out with Dick Bruiser. That is not a man you want to mess around with. Cover two. And shoulder off the mat. This match continues. Hold on, cover, but Mario is down. No one able to count the pin attempt. And now Bruiser and Clement lugging it out, and David trying to keep up that rapid pace that he was looking to set out in this contest. Hold on a moment here. Big sandwich in Sagiri. Looks like this match taking its toll on him. On and then drop. Dick Bruiser just showing how big and how strong he is. David, the crafty veteran, able to outmaneuver these larger opponents. Brad Chad getting hyped up here, possibly setting up for another Smith Especial. No, not yet. David sent again to the outside, and that is going to be a difference maker in this match. If you can isolate your opponent, eliminate the possibility of someone else coming in to interrupt that pin or submission attempt. Oh my God, big spear out of nowhere from Dick Bruiser. Of punches to the face, but hold on, cover, but again, David so crafty, able to stick around the ropes whenever he is in danger. Great. He applies that step over toe hold face lock, but David just relishing in the situation that he's in. Seemingly unbothered by the chaos in the ring. I figure he is just looking for an opportunity to connect with that knockout blow, that maneuver that has ended match after match, but right now these men not giving him a single moment to breathe to do so. Big Uranagi from Brad Chad here, but Brad Chad getting isolated by Newton. Hold on, blazing. Tornado! And there it is, the knockout punch. Going for the cover one. But Newton able to break up the pin attempts and very nearly getting a victory off of David's sure-killing blow.
Ooh.
Looks like David is interested in finishing this match as soon as possible as he stacks up Newton again. Newton now going up top. Big diving elbow. And Newton now in control.
Dick Bruiser doesn't seem to like that as he has injected himself into this situation. God, absolutely devastating lift and then drop. David going with that Enziguri throwback. This is still absolutely anybody's match. He goes for the cover here, however, this could be it. Cover one. Dick Bruiser doesn't see it. But Chad able to get a shoulder off the mat. Cover two. Three count fall. And Chad, the man that has risen from total obscurity, stealing the victory tonight, stealing that number one contender spot that John Newton, that Dick Bruiser, that David Clement were all vying for. And Brad Chad is going to be the man to challenge for Baby Man's title at the Knicks Wrestling Organization Special. But do stay tuned for the bonus match, as we've got one more of those, as that's going to conclude our main program tonight. We have got a bonus match to get through. And let me know what you guys think of. Yeah, if you want, I can do that first, because these will stay here. Let's see. So I'm expecting them to be like pretty standard. We like I personally always balance around 60 overall. Okay, and yeah, it is 60 overall. And I think this is actually kind of the standard of Knicks guys, is like he loads the front loads the Ukemi at the higher values so he can get bigger comebacks. Yeah. That's kind of like, I think the standard for most of his guys is like he wants to get the he wants them to have the big comeback. Because I think if I went to his Nick Vadala, although that might be, that's my version. Let me see here. And then there's, actually, do I have that one? Actually, I might not. Okay, yeah, that's right. I know you made some move list tweaks. Yeah, that's what it was. But, yeah, that is probably why you're seeing, your guys getting reversed more than they are doing reversals in the, end phase of matches, is because, that's how he builds his stuff. Yeah, so the way I usually do it for babyfaces and heels is babyfaces will, for babyfaces, I'll do 15, 25, 20, and then for heels, I'll do 25, 15, 20, because I'm kind of picturing first phase is the shine, second phase is the heat, and the third phase is the comeback, but crucially, I like the idea of leaving it up to chance, because particularly with the way that I run my show is, that is going to add more variance to the situation if the face and the heel have the same ukemi. That being said, having different philosophies for that, for like, all right, the Blake's House stable, the Next Wrestling Organization stable, and the Judgment Pro Wrestling stable totally works, because like having all three stables wrestle their own style is actually pretty cool. So like, I am not saying my way is the way to do it. But I digress. We still have one more bonus match to do. And also, GK, I saw you posting you want big ass. We can do that. So I posted about getting mad at Killer Instinct, which is a game I know fuck all about. Like, is there a story there, or just... And also, if nobody is gonna vote, let's see. Oh, that sucks. If nobody is going to vote on a red corner, I'm going to put Shingo in this. Although I do like Kojima, the leader of the Bread Club. But would also like to see Big Cass get Shingo kicked. You know, as you do. But, I guess takeaways from this week's show. Like, definitely set up some stuff. Because I definitely don't hate the idea. Honestly, like, it's kind of a meme, but, like, taking ranked mode seriously is, like, it's a mistake. Because all it's going to do is make you mad. But, like, if you've got a group of guys that you play with that, like, you enjoy playing with, that shit rules. And that's, like, just universal with fighting games in general. What is it? The DJ Dix versus Nick Vadala, like, I think that's got some legs. On top of that, with, like, DJ Dix's stable of fighters... now coming in to fight the Next Wrestling Organization team and tossing them the Trios title. That can kind of add some fuel to that. Yeah, honestly, that Trios, like I said, that Trios match was super competitive. So, like, definitely enjoyed that, like, all the way through. And like, it's tough for me to call DJ Dix the babyface in that feud, because DJ Dix is like a chaotic entity that transcends the face and heel dynamic. But at the same time, Nick's wrestling organization is kind of still portrayed as like this outsider force that like kind of exists in the show. So I think that makes DJ Dix the face by default. So like him taking the loss in the first like head to head makes sense for long term. Yeah, kind of like that. Yeah, we can definitely see about tweaking Bartholomew so like he doesn't squash as like effectively, and stamina might be a good place to start. I know we nerfed that already. But it's, like, nerfing it to low instead of to average might be a good place without changing his, like, fight style too much. Also, I very much like that, That is true. And we can give him some other stuff to do as, like, priority sequences, because I don't think we used all 10 slots. I like that Solarion and London have literally never won a tag team match. But both of them are, like, beating ass in singles. Which, like, sets up for some stuff down the road.
Yeah!
Certainly. But, that is definitely a... Yeah. So, yeah. And I can definitely get those for you. That is the convenient thing about how I upload these to YouTube. So, yeah, I can get those all broken out and sent to you. I just need to take the time to do it, and it won't take long. What else? And I also feel like Joey is the guy that should be taking the JPW title back to JPW. Because, like, so we're moving a lot of pieces around, and I think we packed a lot of stuff into one show this week. I think a couple of your guys have some at the, but for sure, before we do the, like, Mixed Wrestling Organization show, I'll get a couple of your top guys some custom entrances. Because it would make sense that, like, at your showcase events, your stars get to shine. We could figure out something to do with them. Like, definitely a lot more action in the tag team division, especially now that there's, like, two tag team titles. And Shingo. Vintage Shingo coming up short. You do truly hate to see it. But I'm going to be doing my closing program goodbyes. Of course, if you are new here, if this is your first time watching this stream, we do this every Sunday night right here at twitch.tv/MondayCindy at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time. If you stuck around for the whole show, I'm sure you got to see what was, in my opinion, one hell of a wrestling program. And, we do something like that every week for a little over a year now, so don't see this train stopping anytime soon. Additionally, on Wednesday nights, this week is a little bit up in the air, and the last 2 weeks we didn't even do it. Last week due to weather, and the week before due to real life getting in the way, as it does sometimes. I've got a NHL 20 exhibition with a friend of the channel and friend in real life, Heavy Kira. So Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern time, we'll usually play some NHL 20, and we'll bullshit about whatever dumb things are on our mind on that particular day. If you notice them in the chat, Troll Wizard and the Gatekeeper 24 legitimately could not do this show without them, as they are responsible for at least half the writing that goes into this show. As well as credit to Maglo, you saw him wrestle tonight. Of course, you gotta kayfabe that brother. As DJ Dix, he is responsible for a lot of the original music that you hear on this program. And didn't see him on the show tonight and didn't see him in the chat, but my good friend Lato Copy, responsible for a lot of the graphics and occasionally some writing as well. I mean, certainly when the camera's rolling, it's all me, but when, like, hey, you guys both have great ideas for matchups, for stuff that you want to see, and the quality of this program absolutely improved when I had more people writing out storylines, writing out matchups, than just myself, because that way I personally do not have to juggle a bunch of different stuff at one time. So, like, hey, thanks to both of y'all. I couldn't do it without you. But that is going to be it for tonight. Do be sure to tune in. Next Sunday is up in the air, but highly likely is what I'll say. But certainly look for us Sunday nights right here at twitch.tv/MondayCindy at 7:30 p.m. Eastern. And hope to catch you at the next one. And let me see. I have done this grand sign-off and have not given you guys something to watch. So now I have to sit here and look like an asshole. Continuing to broadcast while I look for that. Who's doing stuff? Let's see. Looks like Blake is streaming, so I'll go ahead and throw you guys at him. Let's see. And yeah, hope to catch you guys down the road.